Hello, and welcome to the making of Dancing on the Doorstep. Now this film, despite how short it is, actually has a surprisingly long story of the making of it. As I was finishing up Warlock, I was also ready for a project that I could do a bit quicker that wouldn't have as much visual effects. I came up with the idea during uni for it to be an animation, but set in modern day. So it would have been a soldier returning from probably Afghanistan instead. But it just never really came up. I sort of shelved the idea until the start of 2020, where I was at a networking event and I met Tom. Now, Tom does a lot of war reenacting and has a lot of his own costumes. You know, he even has his own car from the 40s that he brought to set, which was amazing to have. You know, it wasn't necessary for the story, but it was just really nice to have it on set and have it in the background as a bit of set dressing, just because he had it. You know, why not? And while talking with him at that event, I suddenly thought maybe I could switch the idea to be a 1940s idea, and suddenly like fell in love with it. I was really excited about it. But unfortunately then, obviously the pandemic hit and that put the film on hold. We did kind of hope maybe we'd be able to do it by the summer when it all blew over, and then obviously didn't blow over that quick. During the pandemic though, at least me and Alex could work on the storyboards. We really wanted to play with the idea of the reality and the dream. So as soon as she sees him on the horizon, we swap around the 180 line just to put it a little bit off kilter. And then obviously you'll notice at the end when she realizes it's not real, we go back around onto the other side of the line again. The frames for the dance itself, we decided to draw shots that were a bit more general to be able to be used in the edit of the animatic because we didn't know the specific choreography yet. I just think storyboards are such a valuable part of the pre-production process. I don't think I'd be able to comprehend what I'm doing quite as well without that visual aid to be able to actually see it in sequence and be able to adapt things if they're not working. And just like in my other films, like I've said before, it always saves so much time on set and it helps everyone get on the same page as well. I think rather than reading the script, you can just look at an image and be like, oh yeah, cool, let's do that shot. So looking for the dance music was quite a long process that I kept flip-flopping between different songs. I of course looked at tons of Glenn Miller. His music is obviously very iconic and synonymous with the 40s. And so going through his back catalogue, I found this song, Make Believe Ballroom Time, which not only has the perfect title and also the timings matched. I wanted the song to be able to build up so the dance could start slower and a bit more intimate, and then turn a bit more loose and fun and free as they really lose themselves with each other. So I stripped it down to just the instrumentals, put it into the animatic, and was immediately just loving how it was working, really just as I wanted. It was perfect. Ballroom time, put all your cares away. All the bands are here to bring. So just before the shoot, me and Joanna did a bit of a scout. We took just like an hour or so to block out where things might happen. And I found this incredibly useful for actually planning specifically where the shots would be. So then based on going to the location and actually seeing it in person, I could actually tweak some elements of the script slightly that I thought might work better. So since Tom could already provide his own costumes, Joanna only had to worry about Charlotte's costume, which she ended up actually making completely from scratch. Joanna made the skirt from original 1930s print fabric. She crocheted the cardigan, and the blouse was made from a 1940s pattern. She also sourced online some period accurate shoes, the belt and jewellery. We did toy with the idea of Tom being in his civilian clothes, but we ended up deciding on the army gear because I think the imagery of it is much more powerful if he's in his army gear and she's in those bright colours. So then, a year later, with all pre-production sorted, COVID restrictions lifted, we could finally get out and shoot in August 2021. This was just a two-day shoot and it went incredibly smoothly. I think something that I've definitely got better at is managing the time on set. You know, we got through the script very smoothly, got a lot of options and alternate takes. We took the entire morning of the first day of the shoot to just plan out the dance. So both of the actors are actually dancers as well. So they were both very knowledgeable and very experienced. They know what they're doing. And Tom specifically has also choreographed period dances like this before, which is obviously fantastic for this film. I knew the sort of beats I wanted. I knew a few moments that I wanted out of it, but they were able to turn that into something more technical. And it was a great collaborative experience for us to bounce off of each other. And we wanted this to actually just look like two people spontaneously having a dance in their garden. We didn't want it to look like a routine that they knew off by heart. Like, so the element of like her tripping up over him was planned. Like, I didn't want it to look too perfect. And in the end, I was really, really happy with how the dance came out. Charlotte and Tom both did really, really well doing that dance over and over again in that hot sun. On set as well, Joanna yet again wasn't just doing the costume continuity. She was script supervisor, she was assistant director, she was a runner, she did the catering, she helping me swap lenses. She was wearing so many hats and doing all sorts of different things. And I can't thank her enough. She was just incredible. And I absolutely could not have done it without her. And we also had Liam again as boom operator. And he also shot a lot of the behind the scenes that you're watching in this video. Charlotte also knocked it out of the park at the end. She delivered such a fantastic performance there that I really took the time to let it breathe a lot more than I planned to. Managing to get to that emotional place over and over again. You know, it wasn't too subtle, but it wasn't too over the top. She just kept getting like that perfect balance of emotion for that final bit.
That's a wrap!
Once all that was done, it was then all up to me to edit. Now, the edit was actually quite tough. I really struggled to just actually decide on what take to use. I find that that's always the bit that slows me down, is just choosing a take. It definitely took me the longest to get a final picture lock than I've ever done before. Mainly because of the coverage in the dance itself. I edited it a few different times with completely different angles and takes that I might not have expected to want to use, just to see if there was another option that maybe I hadn't considered. I found this exercise, while tedious, really quite helpful. But there was also some bits that just weren't quite working the way I envisioned them. Once you actually put some things into live action, it doesn't quite flow the way you think it will in your head when you're writing it. And that is part of editing. It is a stage of rewriting the film. But I am happy with the final edit that I got to. It just took me a long time to actually get there. Also, once the edit was locked, Simon could then begin working on the score. There's just something so special about an originally created score. You can search the internet for royalty-free music, or you can get licenses for some music and splice it and make it fit. But an originally created score specifically for that moment of storytelling is just on another level. And it's just so satisfying and so rewarding. And that music exists for this story. For the sequence at the end, we worked with the guitarist Nick Elmer to record the guitar there. And he plays that sequence so softly and beautifully, which was fantastic. When we dropped that in the film, it just elevates that moment so much more. I really, really love that track. It really just helps the emotional punch of that moment. And yet again, Simon has just created fantastic, fantastic music for this. You know, I can't thank him enough for just how much work he puts into these films, and it makes such a difference. It's incredible. I love it. I knew going in that this wouldn't be a very VFX heavy film compared to my others. The weather was quite inconsistent when shooting, so sometimes it would be a clear blue sky, and other times it would be quite cloudy. I was unfortunately getting quite a lot of blown out skies, so I knew I was going to be replacing some of them anyway, but with most of the effects in this film being sky replacements and background fixes for historical accuracies, replacing the metal gates at the end of the lane with wooden gates, taking out satellite dish and wires. The main visual effect in the film is when obviously his hand disappears from hers. I tried that a few different ways, trying to film their hands separately and just have him gently remove his hand. When putting the two separate plates together, I was really struggling to get the shadows to match accurately. So I ended up just using what was shot actually as the reference plate, but I just used that and then cut her hand out using the rotor brush tool in After Effects and then faded his hand away. Which again, just goes to show you should always be shooting lots of different takes, lots of different options, just in case something doesn't work. And then you've always got a different method to be able to achieve the same look. Given that my next film is going to be a completely CGI film, I wanted to challenge myself in photoreal CG. So that opening shot is actually completely 100% CGI, apart from what you see through the window. We couldn't afford to have actually set dressed the room to look like that and actually purchase a period accurate radio. So to be able to do all of that in CGI and make it match so that it's not noticeable was a challenge I was really excited to take on, and hopefully fooled most of you. That was a really, really fun little part of the process. Apart from the render times, that was quite a lot. It was taking like 45 minutes per frame, and that shot is like 20 seconds long. It took nearly a month of overnight renders just to get that opening shot done. But I'm really happy with how it looks, so I think it's worth it. And then I came on to sound design. This is a part of the process that I really do struggle with. I find that usually when I'm working, I love to listen to music. So when I get to sound design, it's always a bit harder to motivate myself. But with this film, at least it was a bit more simple. It's all Foley effects. There's no sounds needing to be originally created for it. There's no magic or robots. It's all just footsteps, breathing, cloth, the things that fill out the background that you'd notice if it wasn't there, but it is necessary. The differences between the sunnier shots and the overcast shots was making the color grade quite difficult. And it's another part of the process that I'm maybe not as experienced in. So I brought in Adam to do the color grade for the film. I wanted to make sure there was definitely a different look between reality and their sort of daydreaming world. I wanted the dream world to look a bit more bright and inviting and lovely and colorful, whereas reality should just be kind of natural, a little bit more desaturated, but just a bit more normal. I'm usually a really big fan of the anamorphic effects. I like the idea of looking at a film through a lens. I like the lens to have a bit of character like that. But for the dance itself, this just didn't feel right. So along with the color grade, the aspect ratio widens. A lot of the anamorphic post effects start to fade away, so that by the time they're in the full flow of the dance, it's a full screen, colorful, lovely, inviting looking image. So that when she then realizes, the aspect ratio comes cramping back down on her and the colors dim back down to the reality. And it definitely helps to accentuate that moment of realization a bit more. Given it's quite a simple premise and quite a short runtime, it is a little frustrating how long it took, but I'm so pleased that it's now out there and finished and online for all to see. I've learned so much from doing this film. You know, you can watch as many videos as you want and you can read as many books, but I think the more you do it, the more you learn. And I learn more and more with each of these films that I do. And I just can't wait to just make the next one and the next one and the next one. So I hope that you enjoyed the film and this behind the scenes video. Please consider subscribing. I'm now going to be moving on to Welcome to Mars, which is a fully CGI animated film. That's a very ambitious project that I'm really excited to be getting off the ground. I'd love to get as many eyes on this as possible. So above anything else, I think if you were to just be able to share the film, that would be really, really appreciated. I'd like to just thank again everyone who worked on this film, everyone who's helped me along the way. You can find Simon's soundtrack on Spotify in the links in the description. And you can also watch Alex's storyboard comparison here by clicking the link on screen or in the description. So thank you so much for watching. I really, really hope that you enjoyed it. And I'll see you next time.